to the close of today's conference, and I guess I'm tasked with kind of bringing it all together, which is pretty, very easy to do. And so, God, I just ask that you will continue to acknowledge us with your presence as you have done all day. Through every presenter, every message that was preached, we could hear the Holy Spirit. And we saw evidence when he delivered those men from pornography addiction. Thank you so much for that. Moving that burden. And now, God, we just ask by your Spirit, speak one more time. Give us a summation of today that we can take away from this conference and walk in until we gather ourselves again together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Brother Bobby talked to you about the Holy Spirit, and then Ray, you could hear the Holy Spirit and how to live a life of significance. And then Pete, who came through in self-examination, which requires the Holy Spirit's presence. And then Sam talked to us from sexual purity. All of these things that these men talked about, it requires the presence of the Holy Spirit in the life of that man.
Yes.
To do what we call strengthening. We call it strengthening, but the actual theological term for it is an empowerment. The Spirit of God empowers you. He gives you the ability to do that which is beyond your natural ability. And he gives you he gives you the know-how to do that which God wants you to do. He empowers you to be able to do that. In other words, he is the supernatural force that God has given us that gives us the ability to do what God wants to do in the earth realm. Say amen to that.
Amen.
Without us working with God, without us joining forces with God, God does not have the hands and the feet that he needs in the earth realm to get the work done. Say amen to that.
Amen.
So I'm just going to give you a few things that you probably already know. And because each of you have the Holy Spirit, then that tells me that you are son of God. Because Romans 8:14 says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. So you're
Amen.
A son of God.
Amen.
Now that's big. That's really big.
Yeah.
To be a son of God, which means that you're an heir of God. That means you partake of what God has. You have been given that which belongs to God. You have already acquired or inherited the characteristics of God. You operate in the nature of God because you are a son of God. And the proof of that is that you are led by his Spirit. The Spirit of God leads you where God wants you to go. He gives you instructions on what God wants you to do. He gives you instructions on how God wants it done, when he wants it done, to who he wants it done to. So as many, and also the text proves to us that there is room for many more sons.
Yes.
All right.
In other words, God has the ability. His adoption quota is unlimited.
Yes.
His adoption, he doesn't care if you once were crazy, he'll fix you. If you were lost, he'll find you. If you were broken, he'll mend you back together. Once God adopts you, whatever was tore up, broken up, whatever the case may be, it will become fixable, and then God can in turn use you, and he relabels you from illegitimate to son.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
I like that, because our earthly dads may have dropped the ball a little bit.
Yeah.
They did the best they could with the knowledge that they had. They did the best. My father, who was an alcoholic, just like some of you have already testified, my dad was an alcoholic, but the reason he was an alcoholic because his dad was an alcoholic.
Yeah.
Say amen to that.
Amen.
And so he left us at an early age, and that's his prerogative. But one thing I thank God for, my mother.
Amen.
Because my mother was not a bitter woman towards my father.
Yeah.
And she always taught me to respect him.
Yeah.
And she always told me, you don't have to be like him, but you will respect him.
Yeah.
So I grew up respecting him, not hating him. And by not hating him, I realized I didn't have to be like him.
Glory.
Amen. Amen.
I didn't have to be like him.
Amen.
I didn't have to be like him. I didn't have to be a womanizer. I didn't have to be a drunk. I didn't have to do that because she taught me not to hate him. I think if I'd had a mother who always preached hating, and I'd probably, because that which you hate, you tend to migrate toward. But I never had hatred for him. And I don't have hatred for him to this day. I buried him when he was 47. He died. He died as a result of his lifestyle.
All right.
47 years old, he was taken out of this earth because of his lifestyle. And so, but that don't have to be me.
Yes, that's right.
Yes.
But still in all, the beauty of it is that, so some people say, well, you come from a single parent home and you're supposed to be this and you're supposed to not have that. I beat the odds, man, by a long way.
Glory.
I beat the odds by a long way. Give all the glory to God because he adopted me.
Amen.
He adopted me through other godly men. Amen. That were filled with his spirit.
Yes.
And they taught me the things that my dad didn't teach me because he was too involved in another kind of lifestyle. Amen. So I didn't miss it. I got everything I was supposed to get. Amen. God made sure I got it all. It came from some came from this guy, some came from that guy. And maybe somebody here today, maybe your dad dropped the ball a little bit. Maybe he dropped it big time, but that's fine. That's fine. He did the best he could with what he had. Now you got a choice. You can either hold that against him or loose yourself from it and accept who God has put in transition in your life, because you're still going to arrive at the same place God wants you to arrive by the Holy Spirit. Say amen to that. So as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Say amen to that. And not only that, God has not given you the spirit of bondage again. Before we got saved, we were in bondage. You are free agents. You are liberty. You are liberty. He hasn't given you the spirit of bondage again to fear, but he has adopted you. He has given you the spirit of adoption. Yes. Now you can say, Daddy.
Yes. Amen.
You can refer to God as Daddy. In other words, now you have the right by the adopting power of the Holy Ghost to call God Daddy. You can make him your earthly father even though he's in heaven. You can lay claim to him. You can lay charge to him. You can do anything you want towards him because he becomes your father.
Amen.
And he will never do anything wrong to you. He will never send you down a wrong path. He will never have you do a wrong thing because he understands that you need the love of a father.
Yeah. Amen.
Not only that, but he can teach you how to give your son what your dad maybe was not able to give you.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Glory be to God.
Yes.
Glory to God. So you see, we have a lot to be thankful for in every God. So we are sons of God. That entitles us to everything that God has. I like that. I really like that.
Me too.
The second thing I want to talk to you about is that the Holy Spirit has adopting power. Say adopting power.
Adopting power.
Say he found me.
He found me.
He looked at me.
Fixed me.
Re-regulated me.
Re-regulated me.
And then adopted me. So if I didn't have a good name. I got one now.
I got one.
Put your hands together, good Lord. The ability to adopt me into the family of God. That is how God adopts me into the family of God. And the evidence of that adoption is I am led by the Spirit. Say amen to that.
Amen.
The second thing you want, another thing you want to say about the Holy Spirit is that he is the revelator of what the Word of God has to say to you.
Amen.
He's the revelator. Not only is the revelator, he's the illuminator. Say amen to that.
Amen.
And the theologians have said that the Bible is written on a third grade education. And it really is. But it can't be interpreted by a third grade.
Come on.
Wow.
Nor can it be interpreted by a PhD scholar.
Amen.
The Bible can only be interpreted by those who are full of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Because even though it's written on a simplified level, you need the Spirit of God to interpret to you or reveal to you what his word is actually saying to you at that particular time.
All right. Yes. All right.
Amen.
So he's the revelator. With that adoption of the Holy Spirit into the family of God, now you have the ability to understand what God requires of you from his word.
Amen.
Remember when I was a little boy growing up in church, he used to always tell me, you'll never know everything about God. God doesn't want you to know everything about heaven. God not going to show you everything. Not God, this God that. It's like, wow, that's really kind of rough on a brother. I'm going to be serving somebody I can't know everything about and don't want me to know everything about him. That's not true. God wants us to know everything there is to know about him. That's why he gave us his spirit.
Yeah.
Amen.
The Spirit of God is God.
Amen.
And he brings to us the knowledge not only of who God is, but what God wants.
Amen.
And not only that, but he empowers us to give God what he wants. Look at that. Nothing like trying to please somebody. You don't know what they want. Kind of like being married. Jed, if you say I said that, I'm going to have to. These fellas know what I'm talking about. You cannot service someone when you don't know what they want.
Yeah.
When you're guessing. And that's what we've been, now a long time, that's what the church does. We try to give God what we think he wants, instead of understanding the scripture and giving what he wants.
Yeah.
Prayer is not difficult when I pray as led by the Spirit of God how to pray.
Okay.
Because when I pray according to the Spirit of God, I give God what he wants.
Yes.
When God gets what he wants, it pulls out of him what I need.
Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah.
So when I'm praying, I don't have to make up a prayer. All I got to do is listen to the voice of the Holy Ghost. He instructs me on how to pray, what to pray, and therefore when I pray according to his instructions, those prayers, I guarantee myself, they get to God.
Amen.
And when my prayers get to God, I get the answers that I'm looking for.
Amen.
I have the answer before I leave my knees and before I leave whatever. So now, in 1 Corinthians, watch this now, the revelator. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 19, it says, but it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them who love him. Paul is saying, it is impossible for any man to know what God has purpose for mankind. There are a lot of people think they know. There are a lot of people guess about what they know. But Paul says it's impossible to know because you'll never know unless God shows it to you.
Yeah.
Say amen to that. Don't you get tired of sometimes people always tell you what God said and how God meant this, and you be like, are you kidding me? God will reveal to you what he wants you to know at the time he wants you to know. And this is one thing I've learned about scripture. Don't ever beat yourself up because you can't quote scripture like chapter 5, verse number 2 like somebody else. That doesn't mean anything. That doesn't mean one thing. You don't need to know the number. You just need to know the word. It's the word that has the power, not the number. Paul says, it is written, he said, look what he says, I have not seen, and been seen, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man, the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Anybody here love God?
Amen.
Now, what Paul is saying, he's saying the natural man. Now, you are not a natural man anymore.
Amen.
You have been moved. Natural means unregenerated, unsaved. You are not that anymore. You are not a natural man. That's not a bad thing. That's a proud thing.
Amen.
So next time you go, you just like me? No, I'm not. No, we may be Latino blood, but then there's another side of me that connects straight back to God. So I'm not exactly like you because I'm not a natural man anymore. I'm not an unsaved man.
Yeah.
I'm not an unregenerated man. I'm not an unredeemed man. I'm a redeemed man.
Yeah.
That makes me different.
Yeah.
I ain't ashamed of that. I'm proud of that because I couldn't have or be involved in the things of God unless my state changed.
That's
right.
Yeah. Amen.
That's right. So he says, it is impossible for a natural man or unregenerated man to understand or even know the things that God has prepared for those that love him. Anybody here love God?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, the scripture says when you love God, that means you do what he said.
Bring it down.
The scripture say, if you love me, keep my commandments.
Yeah.
And then Jesus said, and my commandments are not grievous.
Yeah.
They're not going to rub you the wrong way. If you've really been changed, what I require of you becomes easy for you to do.
Yeah.
Why? Because I've given you the Holy Ghost. You are empowered to do that which I require. So he said, it hadn't been revealed to them. But the next verse in the text, Brett sheds a little light on it when it says, but God has what? Revealed.
Yeah.
How has he done that? By the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
But God has revealed them unto who? Say me.
Mm-hmm.
See, a lot of times when I study scripture, especially one like that, I put my knee pronoun in there. Because I want to reflect directly. If I say us, that include all of y'all.
Right.
I can't speak for all of you. but I can speak for me.
Yeah.
It's been revealed to me what God has prepared for me. So now you got to cross that bridge and get your revelation. Amen to that. You can't ride off mine, because I guarantee what he has prepared for me is different than what he has prepared for you.
Yes.
But if you're his child and if you love him, the Spirit of God is ready or has already revealed to you the plan, the purpose, everything that God has for you.
Amen.
It's not a secret. Say, secret's out.
Secret's out.
But God has revealed them to us by his Spirit. Why? For the Spirit searches all things, the deep things of God. So you have within you, say we have within us, the great revelator.
The great revelator.
The same one that revealed God to Moses, the same one that helped David beat Goliath, the same one that revealed Jesus to Paul, the same one that empowered Mary to get pregnant by no earthly means, I have in us.
Amen.
Same in power, same in authority. He has not decreased one ounce by coming into us.
Good.
It's kind of like, I was the oldest of seven children, so like, when I was in high school, I had brothers and sisters in elementary school. Now, elementary school was right next door to each other, so when someone in the elementary school would bother me, they'd say, I'm going to get my brother. And they knew I was in high school, so they backed down. But I was only like 5'2", 130 pounds in high school. If some of them would have saw me, they'd probably have a different tune, but they would say, I'm going to get my brother. And then that boy brother go to high school. I mean, he'll come over here and clean your clock. You know? Man, that wasn't nothing to me, though. It's what's right. To me, that's what my relationship with God through the Holy Spirit is. I have someone.
Yes.
I got someone that if you bother me too much.
All right. Yeah. That's right.
Yes. I got someone I can go get.
Yeah.
And I can go to if you come at me a little bit too much. I got someone I can go to that can not only make the playing field equal, but give me some dominance.
All right.
So I don't run from the devil. I don't run from his little things he throws out, his little illuminations and his little schemes. No, I don't run from him anymore. Matter of fact, I go looking for him now.
Yeah.
I'm a bully. When it comes to the devil, I'm a bullet. I go looking for him just to beat up on him.
Amen.
Say amen to that. Because the power in me is greater than the power that's in the earth. And if I got the greater power, I need to go be looking for the one who think he got great power and let him know, no, you don't. Say amen to that. So God has, so the Spirit of God becomes, say he becomes a revelator. In that revelation, Jesus told his disciples, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you. Say amen, because he got me. He will guide you into all truth. You're the guy. I'm the guy that knows everything before it happens. I'm the guy that nothing catches me off guard.
Amen.
I'm the guy that is never caught by surprise because I got God in me. When the last time you know anybody sneak up on God? If you can't sneak up on God, you can't sneak up on me, because God is in me.
Come on.
You know what I really like? Our biggest task with the Holy Ghost is learning how to effectively navigate with him. Learn how to hear him. Learn how to recognize his voice. And that's a whole other teaching. Don't have time for that. But learn how to recognize his voice. And learn how to differentiate his voice from all the other voices you hear.
Yes.
You're not crazy. It's just a whole lot of noise. It's just like a whole lot of noise. So we got to learn how to clear the mechanism and zero in on that soft-spoken voice of the Holy Spirit to get the directions, get the clarity. You know, the Word of God, anytime any one of you or I pick up this, if we will but they make this declaration, by revelation of the Holy Spirit, what I'm about to read, I understand.
Amen. Amen.
By revelation of the Spirit. Now I'm going to give you a system to that. Say amen to that.
Amen.
Most things come to us by repetition. Say amen to that.
Amen.
So, if you're studying the Bible, this will work for anybody. If you study the Bible, shorten the amount you read and increase the times you read it.
Amen.
So in other words, instead of just reading through a whole chapter, maybe read one chapter. Read that one chapter a minimum of 10 times. Read it until you begin to recite the words before you see them.
Amen.
That means it's becoming a part of you.
Yes, sir.
Once that takes place, put the Bible down. Then go into your meditation mode. Don't meditate on TV. Meditate on what you just read 10 times.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Meditate. Meditate means to think it over. Start thinking it over in your brain. As you start thinking on your brain, the Spirit of God will begin to give you revelation on what He knows you need to know from the passage you just read.
Amen.
You'll come away. Now, God will then make revelation to you, maybe one of several ways. You'll either hear Him speak inwardly to you, He'll either show you the answer in the Word itself, or He may visit you in a dream and show you a picture of what you just read.
Cool.
But He will give you revelation of what you just read, and it'll be the revelation that you need based on what you just read.
Amen.
Now, you can make that same passage next. We can do the same thing and get a different revelation.
Yes.
Because the Bible is too intense. And the revelator has the ability to peel off different revelations for the time that you are in and what you're seeking for.
Say amen. Amen.
So this, it will work, and He is there to do just that. So He's a great revelator of the Word of God. So with Him in you and with Him in me, right? Say amen to that. I can even go to Revelation to get some understanding.
Amen.
You know how sometimes we dodge those difficult books of the Bible? People always tell me, you'll never understand the book of Revelation. I say, really? Even though the text says, blessed is the person that just read it. He said, I'm not supposed to understand it, just read it.
Amen.
The blessing is in just reading. But I can't read it without getting revelation because I got the revelator in me.
Amen. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Take it back. Now, next thing, so now. You can count on the Spirit of God when He comes into you. And hopefully today, after this singing, we've had someone who has an encounter with Him. But in John 15:26, Jesus tells His disciples what to expect when the Spirit of God comes to them, you know, when he comes into them. And in John 15:26, Jesus says, but when the Comforter is come, I like the way Jesus talked. When the Comforter is come, when he comes, you know, He's going to be there. Whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, that's another name for Him, which proceeded from the Father, He shall do what? Testify of me. So the Spirit of God, the word testify in the text has to do with bearing witness. Bearing witness is like being a witness for someone else or a witness of someone else to someone else.
Yes.
See me there. So the Spirit of God comes into you. He doesn't come to talk to you about you. He comes to talk to you concerning Jesus.
Yes.
Which means He comes to bear witness of the Word of God. Because John 1 says the Word was God. The Word was God, in the beginning the Word was God. So God, Jesus is the Word. So the Spirit of God comes to bear witness, watch this now, of the Word of God to you and I, so we'll know what God is talking about.
Glory.
And know what God wants.
Amen.
That's what he is for. And to guide us in all truth. The truth about anything. Anything. He is there for us. Watch this. Right. You and I should not even be tricked by those who are not real believers. If we use the Spirit in us to discern the Spirit that's in the other person, He'll tell us if they be of God or not.
Yes, sir.
You don't have to take everybody into your circle because they say, I'm a child of God. No, I need you to be verified to me.
Come on.
You pick the right woman. Verify, man.
That's right.
Put this Holy Ghost on it. What you think? I know she looked good, but what you think? Well, she looked good, but there's some devil right there, dude. You don't need to be bothered there. But she real firm, I'm telling you. You can go that way if you want to. But I'm telling you right now, it's going to be trouble, and she's still going to be fine. Say amen to that. So God really, now, bear with me now, because I'm going to have to take you there. We literally have at our disposal, right, the ability to be mistake-proof.
Okay. Wow. Amen.
With the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
We have the ability to not walk in mistakeism. Mm. But it requires complete submission to Him in your life. Save me today.
Amen.
It's kind of like my mom said. My mom used to tell me, if you didn't do what I say, I quit whipping your behind. In other words, you got the ability to be mistake-proof if you just do what I say and not what you want to do.
Yes. Yes.
See? That's kind of deep because really, when we look at our naturalness, it's kind of automatic that we have to make mistakes. That's the natural progression of things. That was if you were a natural man.
Amen.
But you've moved from naturalism to spiritualism. Even though you're in a natural body, you're a natural man, but you operate on spiritual principles. Which gives you the ability and gives me the ability to literally be mistake-proof if I submit myself to the direction of the Holy Ghost. He's there to guide me in all truth. Say amen to that.
Amen.
Now that's probably a big stretch, and you have to, you have to kind of grow to that, but that's what the scripture said. So, he will testify of Christ. The last thing I want to tell you is, well, how do I receive him? Because in teaching today, not many teachers around of scripture, not many instructors around, that the Spirit of God has given the gift of instruction on how to show people how to receive the Holy Ghost, how to recognize his presence, and even how to operate under his jurisdiction. But there's a simple process that the Word of God gives us on how to receive him. Now, first of all, let me tell you this. The Holy Spirit is one of your promises that God has declared for you.
Yes, sir.
And according to Corinthians, all the promises of God in him are yes, and in him are amen. So it's not a matter of if God wants you to have the Holy Ghost. So that's part of my package. Amen. And I'm not gonna get a good cooked T-bone steak with potatoes and green beans and just eat the green beans and potatoes and eat the steak. Now I'm going after that meat.
That's right.
That's the meal right there. Say amen to that.
So
he says this. So in the text here, the easiest way to grab a hold of how to get the Holy Spirit is through the Word of God. In Luke chapter 11, verse 10 through 13, Jesus was talking to his disciples. He says this: "For everyone that asketh, receiveth. And he that seeketh, findeth.
Amen.
And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened." So if you make the right move, you'll get what you're looking for.
Amen.
Next verse he says, "If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will you give him a stone?" The answer to that question is no. Unless you got problems. Right? Or if you ask of a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? So if your son asks you for bread, you give him bread. If he asks you for a fish, you give him a fish and not a serpent. Because you're a loving father.
Amen.
You're a caring father. And you're a father who wants your child to have the best or have what he needs. Say amen to that.
Amen.
Then in the verse number 20, so if you ask him an egg, will you offer him a scorpion? Those things to me are kind of far-fetched, but I think Jesus is trying to give us an example here of that earthly fathers do not operate all that differently than your heavenly father. Remember, sometimes we give our children stuff we know we shouldn't be giving it to them, but we just give it to them anyway because we want them to have it. Last part of the text, it says, if you then, he says, being evil, right, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that what?
Ask.
But you ask in faith. The text says, how much more will God give the Holy Spirit to them but ask? None. If you stretch that word ask, because the Holy Spirit is a promise, the word ask in the text has to do with you make a declaration or a demand. Not like, God, you know, Spirit. You make a demand. You can always make a demand on something that's yours.
Amen.
Who got an ATM card? Could you hold it up for me for a minute there? Got any money in the bank? Hold up the ATM card. What bank is it on? Grove Financial? Hold it up. Who's got another one? What you got? What's yours on? Wells Fargo. Anybody got another?
BB&T.
Who got another?
Region.
Forest Central. Who else? Regions. Probably got it.
Cornerstone.
SunTrust.
Decency.
All of ATM cards. Hold them up. Get them on. Watch it. Either one of those cards are interchangeable at any institution.
Amen. That's right.
What makes them work if you got cash? Amen to that. What makes them work? Like, he can take his, could I hold that for a minute? He can take his girlfriend and you don't even let him hold it. Like, he can take his growth financial card and he can go to GTE and put it in there. And if his PIN number is right and he has cash, it'll say, we can process this transaction, but it's going to cost you like $2. It's going to cost you like $1. So either one of those cards are interchangeable at any institution. Now, but the beauty of the card is, if I go somewhere else,
yes,
it's going to cost me extra to get out what's mine. But if I go to the institution,
yes,
that my card is drawn on,
yes,
and I got money, all I need is the right PIN number.
Yes, sir.
If I got the right PIN number, I can get up to the maximum amount, yes, based on what I have in there, and it don't cost me a thing.
Yes,
sir. The Spirit of God belongs to you.
Yes.
Matter of fact, you do God an injustice when you don't ask for him. He's yours. You don't have to go to another institution. You don't have to go to another person or another place. You make a demand on God because he is a promise to you already. He's a promise to you already. And so like this, there's no need of eating chicken when steak has been given. Say amen to that.
Amen.
You don't care how much you like chicken.
Yes.
But steak is just an upgrade. You got problems. Say amen to that. Why is that important? Why is that important? God wants me to have the Holy Ghost so I won't struggle in my walk. Without him or not having access to him, I struggle in my walk. And God doesn't want my walk to be one of struggle. Because if I struggle, I'll lose heart. I'll faint. Might even quit if it becomes too much of a struggle. We guys, we don't like to struggle. We don't want struggle. And the Holy Spirit moves struggle. It gives me, it empowers me, gives me the ability to walk in what God requires of me without the struggle. I have to learn how to surrender to his will and put my will wherever. Just get it out of the way.
Yes, sir.
Say amen to that.
Amen.
So the Spirit of God is a promise to me, it's a promise to you, and all we have to do with the promise. Jesus said in John 6:23, I believe, he says, until now, talk to his disciples, until now you have asked nothing in my name. I did a study on that one time, through the Gospels. You know them boys never prayed? They never prayed. They never had to do anything but hang. He did all the praying. Supernaturally, he fed them. And I'm watching the whole time with them. Neither one of them got sick. They never talked about changing clothes. They never talked about shoes wearing out. Because Jesus, and he gets to this point where he's about to leave, he says, until now, you've been walking and not doing a thing.
Yes.
He said, until now you have not asked anything in my name. I've been doing it all. He said, but now I'm leaving. I want to institute a new form of operation between you and me.
Yes.
Basically, what Jesus is saying is I've kind of demonstrated to you for the past 3 years how to get out of God what you want.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have to be careful how you talk about this around holy folk, religious people.
Yeah.
Religious people got a real problem with you talking about what you can get from God and how you can get it all the time. They have a real problem with it. So you may have to downplay that. You may have to downplay that a little bit of a low key or find some folk who think like you and then y'all can talk about it among yourself. But you can't talk about this stuff around religious people.
Okay.
Religious people think you ought to bribe that kind of stuff. But I was like, you can get all you can get. God on it. I gotta have some. Jesus said, until now you have not asked, you have not made demand on one thing. He says, but now demand it.
Yes.
Put a demand on it. Well, now you have not asked one thing in my name. Ask, and it shall be given you.
Yeah. That's right.
it shall be given. Why? God wants you to have it.
Amen.
Sure, I know you. Peace, you like peace, where you like joy. I know you like all of that, don't you? You like a little money too.
Yes.
Well, I do. Sleep a lot better with money in my pocket or in the ATM machine. Say amen to that. Then we're not being in there, right? Say amen to that.
Amen.
See, like I said, you have to learn how to talk. You have to talk this to some other people.
Yeah.
Y'all get them rubbing y'all the wrong way. Yeah, I mean, I love having peace. I love having joy.
Amen.
I love all the internal things that go with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I love all of that. I love all of that. But a nice car is a nice car, man.
Amen.
Money in the bank is money in the bank, man.
Yes, sir.
Nice clothes, nice shoes. Hey, if I got to be the part, I might as well look the part and be proud of the part because they all are blessings from God.
Amen.
If you can receive that, put your hands together. You know, one of the days when you come to the end, like, you got so much information, you want information overload. You know, if it's one more thing, and I just might explode. But I wanted to share that with you because the Holy Spirit, he is the person of God, Spirit.
Amen.
He's the mind of God. He's the thoughts of God. He's the wisdom that is God. And then God says, I want you to know everything about me, so I'm going to give you him.
Yes.
Because if I give you him, there's no way you can come up with what I want on your own.
Amen.
And that's why we have so much division among the church now. Baptists trying to give him one thing. Methodists trying to give him one thing. God said, if y'all could just get it together. I've given you myself. Stop guessing and just give me what I want.
Amen.
If we could just give God what he wants, and the Holy Spirit is there to help us understand it.
Amen.
And to know that, and that's what we do. So when we give God what he wants, he gives us exactly what we want and what we need. And so he's here today, and this morning we saw his power and demonstration when he delivered those men from pornography. And you may be here today, and if you want to receive him, it's just a matter of asking in faith, because he is a promise. And the second thing is too, you know, you may be here today, and sometimes in working for God, it can get kind of tiring sometimes. Working for God can get tired. You know, working for God can sometimes, you know, especially when you go through life, because, you know, as men of God, we're not excluded from persecution. Matter of fact, man, we start working with God, you kind of go to the front line of this thing. You know, you're right. God throw you right out of here.
Hey.
He throw you right out front, then put a bulls on your chest and one on your back. Go ahead and take a shot at them. They're my boys. They can handle it. But sometimes this constant persecution kind of gets you a little bit, man. They got a little remedy for that. There were a couple boys named Peter and John. As they were preaching in Jerusalem, they were snatched by the Sanhedrin. They were handcuffed and brought before the counselor. And they were threatened not to preach Jesus anymore. But before they let them go, they put them 40 lashes. 40 lashes. And let them go. And Peter and John, they threatened and said, look, I want you preaching no more, teaching no more in that name. So Peter and John left. And so they went and found some companions that believed like they believed.
Yes.
And they went and they had prayer. And they prayed to God. And what their prayer was, God, they had already made up their mind that they were going back the next day to preach. They're going. You can't, sometimes you know when God's got a hold of you, you just can't beat me down.
Yeah.
Not make me. I'm gonna go do what I gotta do.
Yeah.
But basically, what they ask in their prayer was, God, just give us some boldness.
Yeah, yes.
Sometimes in this walk, you need a fresh infill, a fresh touch. Sometimes the old preachers say a fresh touch from God, but you need a new energizing. Because you still got to go back and fight the fight.
Yeah.
But because of what you've been going through, because of the persecution, you feel a little weak, you feel a little downtrodden. God, you go, I'm going back, but I don't feel like I need to feel going back. That's when you need a booster shot of the Holy Ghost. They just said, their prayer was, God, just grant us boldness that we preach and teach in the name of Jesus. And the Bible says when they ended their prayer, the place shook. It shook. and the Bible says they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. These guys had been filled with the Holy Spirit one time before. So that gives us this affirmation. So if you've been filled before, you're going to always need a new infilling every time the job changes. Or every time what you have to face changes, you need a new shot. You need a new booster for what you're going into. Remember, you may be going to the same people, but the mission is different. And when the mission shifts, you need a booster. And that booster gives, that booster empowers you again to do what you couldn't do on your own. And it makes what you do effective. Don't ever think, see, I'm kind of like Pete. And I have to put a check on myself. I know in the natural what I'm able to do. In the natural, I can preach you out of your seat. I know I can do that. So I have to back me down.
Yeah.
I have to really make myself depend on the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen.
I have to make myself. I make myself acknowledge Him because I know what I can do on my own. But I don't want to be on my own because the effect won't be the same.
Amen.
I want it to be done through me by Him.
Amen.
So if you come up out of your seat when I'm talking, it's by Him. You coming up out of your seat for something real. But if you come up out of your seat when I'm just doing it on my own, you might well sit down. Say amen to that.
Amen.
But you need a fresh infill. It's for anything. You know, just living, working a job, marriage, family, anything. You need a fresh infilling of the Holy Ghost to empower you so you can continue being the man of God at the same strength and the same pace that you've always kept. Amen? So if you receive that, just kind of stand and join hands with the guy next to you. Yeah, just kind of stand. Line up across the aisle. Join hands with the guy next to you.
Come on in here.
I'm going to pray. First of all, is there anybody here today that has not accepted Jesus as their personal Savior? Anybody here today that has not accepted Jesus as their personal Savior? Anyone here today? So that makes you all in the right place. Right. Father, in the name of Jesus, we've had a great day. Yeah, by your Spirit, you have encouraged us, you have taught us. You have moved us from one plateau to another. And we thank you for that, God. We thank you for being true to your promises and to your word. But God, we stand now specifically for two reasons in the name of Jesus. First, we stand, and if there be any here, we stand, and we're asking in the name of Jesus that we be filled with the Holy Spirit, with the evidence of speaking in tongues in the name of Jesus. And then others of us, we are standing because we've been waging war real frequently. And the desire is really strong, but the body is kind of weak. And we understand that persecution is only on our radar. We understand it. But we just ask now, in this particular case, that you empower us for what's ahead. You empower us for what we have to face. Empower us for the decisions we have to make by your Holy Spirit. We know, according to your word, that he is ours. And so we are asking that he fill us with himself now from the top of our heads to the sole of our feet. And we're asking that he empower us once again from the top of our head to the soles of our feet. In the name of Jesus. And according to your word, God, we declare that we receive him. Even now. In the name of Jesus, we declare it. We declare ourselves filled. We declare ourselves replenished. We declare ourselves bold now in the power of the Holy Spirit. So God, we thank you now. Come on, we thank you now. We thank you right now for this filling. We thank you now for this recharging that is taking place in our lives right now. We give you praise for that. We glorify you for that. We magnify you for that. In Jesus' name. All that agree, said amen.
Amen.
Amen.